Dear brothers and respected elders, we begin in the name of Allah. Thank Him, praise Him, glorify Him, seek His forgiveness and ask Him to send His infinite mercy upon His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to forgive our sins and to guide us all to the right path so that we can all live like Muslims, die like Muslims and rise like Muslims on the day of Qiyamah. Some of you might be thinking, why are we talking about Imam Abu Hanifa? Well, the reason is very simple. In many circles, in many parts of the world, many, especially amongst the youth, speak ill of this great Imam. He is referred to as Al-Imam Al-Azam, the greatest amongst the Imams. Some people are even allergic to this title. They say, well, why do you call him Al-Imam Al-Azam? The literal meaning of Al-Imam Al-Azam means the greatest Imam. So they say Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the greatest Imam. So why do you refer to Abu Hanifa as the greatest Imam? Well, it shows that these people who make this objection don't even understand the term themselves. This is why they lay this accusation. Because the reason being, Al-Imam Al-Azam means the greatest Imam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the greatest amongst Allah's creation. He was the greatest amongst the prophets. It's like somebody asking you, brother, where do you live, London or England? Immediately anybody with any understanding of the term will understand this person, he doesn't know what he's talking about. London is in England. And so if you want to ask the question, ask, where do you live, London or Birmingham, London or Manchester, London or Paris? And if you want to refer to England, then you ask, do you live in England or France, England or Pakistan? It makes sense. So how can anybody possibly compare Abu Hanifa rahimahullah or any other Imam for that matter to any prophet, let alone Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So when we refer to Rasulullah, we say Imamul Anbiya. Imamul Anbiya wal Mursaleen, Sayyidul Awwaleen wal Akhireen, Rahmatul Lil Alameen, Khatamul Nabiyeen. He is the greatest among all the prophets of Allah. When we say Al-Imam Al-Azam to Abu Hanifa, it automatically implies the greatest amongst the Imams within the Ummah. We compare him to people like Imam Malik, Imam Shafi, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Bukhari and other Imams who were great scholars in this Ummah. And this is not a title which has been given to Imam Abu Hanifa by Hanafis. This is a title given to Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah by the greatest of the scholars in this Ummah who were not Hanafis. One of the great scholars in the Islamic history was a man by the name of Shamsuddin Zahabi. He was a student of Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. He's compiled a wonderful book entitled Tadhkiratul Huffaz. He was an 8th century scholar. So obviously he can only have compiled the affairs of scholars up to his time. So from Sahaba through Tabi'in and Taba Tabi'in and so on up to his time, he's listed in there many hundreds of greatest scholars of Islam. And when commenting on Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he has mentioned him as Al-Imam Al-Azam, the greatest of the Imams. And then he says, while by talking about others and mentioning them, he's listed under some great Imams, half a page, some a few pages. And he's commented on Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah saying, I suffice with just 2 pages. And he says, this doesn't do his status and his nobility justice. So I have written a special book regarding him. Imam Shamsuddin Zahabi rahimahullah, that is what he says. And when referring to Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he says Al-Imam Al-Azam. Similarly, other great scholars, there was a great Maliki scholar, Abdul Barr rahimahullah, he was an imam in his own way. He also referred to Abu Hanifa rahimahullah as Al-Imam Al-Azam. So Allah put this in the minds and in the hearts of people. And when the great scholars of the past used to refer to Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, they mostly used to refer to him as Al-Imam Al-Azam, the greatest Imam, meaning in this Ummah, when compared to other Imams. Reason being, he was the pioneer, he was the first of such great scholars and Imams. So the first is usually distinguished. And then throughout the history of Islam, more people have benefited from the knowledge and the legacy which Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah left behind. And so more people have followed him compared to any other Imam. So this in itself is conclusive proof that he is Al-Imam Al-Azam, and this title is fully fitting for him. Perhaps even if we were to say more people follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah than the rest of the Imams put together, we won't be wrong. More than half, or at least around half, the Ummah throughout its history has been following Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, even to the present day. Arabs, our Arab brothers, they only make up a small percentage of the Ummah. There's probably more Muslims than just India than all the Arab world put together. In India, there's almost 300 million Muslims. Saudi Arabia, the original Arab population of Saudi Arabia, is only 7-8 million. Egypt, Iraq, Libya, you put all the Arab countries together, there's more Muslims in India alone than all the Arab countries put together. And mashallah, when you combine with Pakistan, Bangladesh, and all the Turkish countries, which are the Central Asian republics, they all follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. So there's been, even to the present day, more people follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah than the rest of the world put together. And when we say they follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, I do not mean for one moment or second that they follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah compared to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah in those issues in which ijtihad is required. Imam Abu Hanifa wasn't a Rasulullah. He wasn't a prophet of Allah. Nobody considers him as such. He's a mujtahid scholar, and in the Quran, Allah commands us to follow mujtahid scholars. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. Obey Allah, obey His Messenger and the people of authority amongst you. So there are people in this ummah that Allah has commanded us to follow. So people say, where did Abu Hanifa come from? Does it say in the Quran, follow Abu Hanifa? Or did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, follow Abu Hanifa rahimahullah? Of course, the Rasulullah didn't mention that by name. And the Quran doesn't mention by name. But the Quran describes the people, their status, and their mission that we should follow. People of authority. And mujtahids have the ultimate authority in deen. Their scholarship, their knowledge, what Allah has blessed them with. And in another verse in the Quran, Allah has made it a bit more clear. Allah says, وَإِذَا جَاءَهُمْ أَمْرٌ مِّنَ الْأَمْنِ وَالْخَوْفِ يَذَاءُوا بِهِ وَلَوْ رَدُّوهُ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ وَإِلَىٰ أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْهُمْ لَعَلِمَهُ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَنْبِطُونَهُ مِنْهُمْ وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ لَاتَّبَعْتُمُ الشَّيْطَانَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. People should refer matters to Allah. رَدُّوهُ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ وَإِلَىٰ أُولِي الْأَمْرِ. Refer matters to the Messenger of Allah and to the people of authority amongst them who can make the right istimbat, the right ijtihad, come to the right conclusion in complicated issues. And if Allah is commanding us to do this, and had Allah not commanded us to do this, and had it not been His mercy, وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ لَاتَّبَعْتُمُ الشَّيْطَانَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا, then you would have surely followed shaitan. لَاتَّبَعْتُمُ الشَّيْطَانَ. You would, لَاتَّبَعْتُمْ. This is affirmation, stress. You would have definitely followed shaitan. Illa qalila, except few amongst you. And who are those few? Those few are those who are mujtahid themselves, or people of very sound learning. Otherwise, the majority of the people, the safest way for them is to follow mujtahid scholars. So mujtahid scholars are a blessing of Allah upon this ummah. So when we say we follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, or people have been following Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, or other imams and other mujtahid scholars, it doesn't mean in comparison to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Once Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah was giving a dars, a lecture, and somebody came up and said, Imam, stop this nonsense. What's this qiyas that you've started? And shaitan was the first person to perform qiyas. When Allah commanded the angels and said to them, gathered them and said, Usjudu li Adam, make sajda to Adam. فَسَجَدَ الْمَلَائِكَةُ كُلُّهُمْ أَجْمَعُونَ إِلَّا إِبْلِيسِ All the angels made sajda except Iblis. And then he made qiyas. He made ijtihad for himself. And he said, أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنُ I'm better than him. You made him from dust. And you made me from fire. So why should I make sajda to him? So this man said to Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, that you are doing the same thing that shaitan did. Made qiyas. Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, may Allah enlighten his grave and elevate his status in paradise. And may Allah grant us his love and love of all great scholars and friends of Allah as we ought to love them. Imam Sahib calmly said, there is a fundamental difference between qiyas of shaitan and the qiyas that we are doing. The qiyas that shaitan did, he did it for justification of rebelling against Allah and rejecting His command and disobeying Allah. The qiyas that we do is in order to obey Allah. So there is a difference. What shaitan did, his qiyas, to compare himself with Adam, he said, I am better than Adam. خَلَقْتَنِي مِن نَار وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِن طِين You made me from fire, made him from teen, from sand, from clay. So I am better. So he justified his refusal to make sajda to Adam alayhi salam, and hence disobey Allah. But the qiyas Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah and the other Aimmah Mujtahideen used to do was in order to facilitate obedience of Allah. And I will explain, Allah willing, in this brief session. And the first thing, why are we talking about Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah? Because he is amongst a few of the great scholars in the history of Islam. And this has generally been the practice and the way in throughout history of humanity. All great people have had more than their fair share of critics. Which great man has there been in the history of humanity who hasn't had criticism in one way or another? Adam alayhi salam was the first great man. Allah says in the Quran, when Iblis refused to bow down to him and make sajda to him, Allah said, مَا مَنَعَكَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِمَا خَلَقْتُ بِيَدَيَّ What prevented you from making sajda to someone I made with my hand? So he had criticism of him. The greatest man in the history of humanity, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, didn't people criticize him? Bhi Hazur pe criticism nahi hui. Didn't people object to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah, he says, people who criticize Abu Hanifa rahimahullah is either for two reasons. Either they don't know how noble he was, or they are simply jealous of him. This is what the Jews were. They were jealous of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ مَا عَرَفُوا كَفَرُوا بِهِ Previously, وَكَانُوا يَسْتَفْتِحُونَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا They used to make wasila of Rasulullah, seek victory from Allah with the barakah of Rasulullah against their enemies. But فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ When he came to them, مَا عَرَفُوا They recognized him. وَكَفَرُوا بِهِ They recognized him and rejected him and denied him. In another verse, Allah says, حَسَدًا مِّنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِهِمْ Because of jealousy. They wanted Rasulullah to be from amongst them. Any excuse, Bani Israel wanted to reject Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So all great people in the past have had critics. And Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah has had more than his fair share. And in recent times, people, subhanallah, you know, people from who have very little knowledge, understanding or no status are coming up. Abu Hanifa, well, he only knew 17 hadiths. Some say only 5, some say 7. Some, if they feel generous, they say, well, he only knew 17 hadiths. One of our scholars, he said, well, if Abu Hanifa rahimahullah only knew 17 hadiths, then you can guarantee there wasn't a single person in the entire Muslim world who knew 18. The reason being, Banu Abbas, they tried their utmost to appoint Abu Hanifa rahimahullah to the post of Chief Justice, Qadi al-Qudat. And who does a government or any empire or state appoint as the Chief Justice? Some low learned or the highest learned man in the state? What do you think? The high, most learned man. So much so, they even imprisoned Abu Hanifa rahimahullah in order to force him to accept the post of Chief Justice. Why? Because they knew he is the most knowledgeable and the most learned and probably the most intelligent man of his time. Had there been anybody more knowledgeable and more intelligent in their eyes, in their opinion, then they wouldn't have come to Abu Hanifa to offer him the post of Chief Justice. They would have gone to him. But they forced him so much so, and Abu Hanifa rahimahullah kept refusing. They imprisoned him, and in prison, they tried to force him to accept this post. But Imam Sahib kept refusing. He was tortured. Then his janazah came out of prison. So had there been anybody in the Islamic world more knowledge than Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, then they wouldn't have come to him. They would have gone to that person. So any time a person says, Abu Hanifa only knew 17 hadiths. I was speaking to someone few years back, young university student. And the way he came up, he said, we know for a fact Abu Hanifa only knew 17 hadiths. Allahu Akbar. So if he only knew 17 hadiths, then you can guarantee there wasn't a single person in the whole Islamic world who knew 18, otherwise they would have gone to him. But in fact, these 17 hadiths that people refer to, ulama have explained, they were 17 hadiths Imam Abu Hanifa heard directly from Sahaba. And people had then distort information and corrupt it in order to put the great Imam down, Allahu Akbar. Whereas in reality, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he learned hadith from he learned knowledge of deen. His main teacher was Hamad bin Abi Sulaiman in Kufa. But scholars have stated from almost 4,000 scholars. So a man who attended the circle and dars of 4,000 muhaddiseen, fuqaha, sahab, and such learned people. How is it possible that he only knew 17 hadiths? He had the good fortune to attend the majalis and the durus of people like Ata bin Abi Rabah rahimahullah. People say, well, Abu Hanifa, one of the things people criticize him, his narrations were da'if. His opinion was based on da'if hadiths, weak hadiths. Where Imam Bukhari rahimahullah has compiled a work which is recognized as one of the greatest works in the history of Islam. His compilation of hadith referred to as Sahih Bukhari. People of knowledge usually refer to it as Asahul Kutubi Ba'da Kitabillah, the most authentic book after the book of Allah. This term, Asahul Kutubi Ba'da Kitabillah, the most authentic book after the book of Allah, this term in itself needs understanding. Because this does not imply for one moment that everything in Bukhari is absolutely authentic. Because if it was, then that means it would be equal to the Quran. Because the Quran, the first declaration, the first statement, claim made by Allah in the Quran is ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِي. This is the book in which there is no doubt. This is the book, meaning this is the only book in which there is no doubt. When we say this is the book in which there is no doubt, it implies this is the only book in which there is no doubt. If there was no doubt in anything in even Sahih Bukhari, then that would make it equal to the Quran. So when we say Asahul Kutubi Ba'da Kitabillah, the most authentic book after the book of Allah, that means relative to others. Relative to other books. But it doesn't mean everything in Sahih Bukhari should be taken literally by an ordinary person on the street. Obviously, I am not saying that there are things wrong in Sahih Bukhari. No. Perhaps this will need explanation as well. Because there can be nothing wrong with what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has stated or done. But there can be mistakes in the transmission of that statement. And there can be issues in the way people understand. And even Imam Bukhari, rahmahullah, he just like people say, well, Abu Hanifa wasn't Rasulullah, was he? So was Imam Bukhari Rasulullah? If Abu Hanifa, rahmahullah, or any other Imam is not infallible, is not masoom, was Imam Bukhari masoom? So the same principles which people apply or use to criticize Abu Hanifa, rahmahullah, the same principle can be applied to all other scholars, to Imam Bukhari. Many people who are allergic to the term Al-Imam Al-Azam, they have no hesitation in using the term Shaykh al-Islam for Ibn Taymiyyah, rahmahullah, for example. Shaykh al-Islam. You know, one person says, brother, this is my Shaykh. In other words, he's a teacher. Shaykh al-Islam, the teacher of Islam. Did Ibn Taymiyyah, rahmahullah, teach Islam? So when people use different titles, Allahu Akbar. So if people use the same terminology, or the same balance, or the same scale, then people should be uniform. If there is a problem with using the term Al-Imam Al-Azam for Abu Hanifa, rahmahullah, then should there not be a problem for using the term Shaykh al-Islam for Ibn Taymiyyah, rahmahullah? But we never criticize that. We don't object to that. Because we understand what it means to refer to someone as Imam al-Azam or any other title. So I was saying, some of you might be wondering why we are talking about Imam Abu Hanifa, rahmahullah. I've given one reason, that he's had more than his fair critics throughout the history, and people wrongly, if I was to say ignorantly or even arrogantly, I wouldn't be wrong. If you hear some of the criticisms people make and the way they place that criticism on Imam Abu Hanifa, rahmahullah, it sends shivers down a person's spine, that how can a Muslim talk ill in such a manner of this great scholar of Islam? In Sahih Bukhari, Imam Bukhari, rahmahullah, has presented a hadith Qudsi, in which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah himself, he says, man aada li waliyan faqad adantuhu bil harb, whosoever has a grudge against any of my friends, Allah says, I have declared war with him. So Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, wasn't just a believer and a scholar, he was a great saintly man, a great friend of Allah. So anybody who has any grudge in his heart for Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, or any of the great imams, then that means that person is at war with Allah. So if a person is at war with Allah, where does that leave? Where will that leave him? And so when many young people, youngsters, out of supposed label of deen, out of the supposed label of Quran and Sunnah, are being turned against such great a'imma, they are not being brought to Quran and Sunnah, they are being made enemies of Allah. So is it not our responsibility to rescue and save such youngsters? And this is the sunnat of Allah himself. Somebody might think, we've heard sunnat of Rasulullah, but where did sunnat of Allah come from? Sunnat of Allah is in the Quran. سنة الله ولن تجد لسنة الله تبديلا. سنة of Allah is such. In other words, Allah's law, the way Allah does things. Just as سنة of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the way Rasulullah used to do things, سنة of Allah is the way Allah does things, Allah's laws. And one of Allah's sunnats is إن الله يدافع عن الذين آمنوا. Allah defends the believers. And in the first instance, when this ayat was revealed, who were the believers? Sahaba. So anybody who criticizes Sahaba, Allah used to come to their defense. So now, if any Muslim believer is criticized, attacked anywhere, it is an obligation upon the Muslims. It is the sunnat of Allah. And it is our responsibility to defend their honor. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his farewell sermon, millions of Muslims are now congregating around Makkatul Mukarramah for the performance of Hajj. When Rasulullah performed Hajj, his one and only Hajj from Madinatul Munawwara, referred to as Hajjul Islam or Hajjatul Wida, the farewell Hajj, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned only a few things. In fact, this was Rasulullah's only opportunity to address such a large gathering. When he used to be in Makkah, making da'wah in the streets and in the homes, people used to shut their doors, stay away from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet came to Medina, Medina was a small town. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had only one opportunity to address such a large gathering of 100,000 plus. When Islam had prevailed all over Arabia, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then felt, oh Allah Rabbul Alameen Jalla wa Ala, in his divine wisdom and knowledge, felt it was now the right time for my beloved Prophet to perform Hajj. The Prophet was ordered by Allah to prepare, and the Prophet sent out messages to all parts of Arabia that I will be performing Hajj and whosoever can come. So people gathered from all over Arabia. And when Rasulullah addressed them in Arafat, he started by asking the people, oh people, what day is this? What month is this? What place is this? And the people responded, the day of Arafah, in this blessed month of Dhul-Hijjah, and in the plain of Arafah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, oh people, be aware, the honor of other Muslim is haram upon you, like the honor of this day, in this month, in this place. So no Muslim should insult another Muslim. No Muslim should hurt another Muslim. No Muslim should do anything to insult or humiliate or cause any harm to another Muslim. If that is the case for ordinary Muslims, what about the scholars of Islam? Awliya Allah, scholars of Islam who are successors and heirs to prophets. Inna al-ulama'a warathatul anbiya. Ulama, they are the heirs and successors of the prophets. And Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he wasn't just an ordinary imam, an ordinary alim. He was such an alim. Another great scholar of Islam, Imam Shafi rahimahullah said, and Imam Shamsuddin Dhabi has reported and recorded this in Tazkiratul Hufaz. He says, Imam Shafi, he said, Inna nasa ayalu Abi Hanifa fil fiqh. When it comes to understanding of deen, the whole humanity, the whole ummah are like children in front of Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. So one of these grand scholars of this ummah. So when people look down upon him and criticizing him, then Allahu Akbar, they think they are doing people a favor by criticizing Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. Whereas in fact, they are turning these people to become enemies of Allah. And at war with Allah. A famous Sahih hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ad-deenu nasiha. Deen is wishing well. Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, for who? Wish well for who? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated, Lillahi wa li rasulihi wa li a'immatil muslimina wa ammatihim. To wish well for Allah, for His Rasul, and for the Imams of the Muslims and their general public. A Muslim should wish well for all these. So a person who doesn't wish well for the great scholars of Muslims, what sort of a Muslim can he possibly be? So I was saying, it is the sunnah of Allah to defend the honor of believers. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And this isn't a weak hadith from somewhere. This is a verse of Quran, Suratul Hajj, that Allah Himself defends the honor of believers. So what about the great scholars of Islam? People because of whom Allah has benefited the ummah, and people throughout the world, throughout the history of Islam, have been benefiting from the likes of such great scholars. If I can present a question and think about its answer, yeah, then inshallah it will help you to understand the topic. Many people, although born Muslims, live early parts of their life away from Islam for whatever reason. Bad friendship, they didn't get a good upbringing, they didn't get a good education, or they weren't Muslims, they were born in non-Muslim families. But as they grow older, Allah guides them and they want to come to the right path. They want to start praying, for example. Many Muslims, especially after spending time in Jamaat, Tablighi Jamaat, 3 days, 10 days, then they want to start following deen. And one of the most important things in our deen is learning to pray. Is praying. So in order to pray properly, you need to learn to pray. So just imagine this scenario. A young man comes to Imam Sahib, Imam of this masjid or any other masjid for that matter, and he says, Shaykh, I've been very sinful, you know, I've wasted my life, and I've started to pray, but I can't pray properly. I want you to please teach me how to pray properly. Now this Shaykh, he can either do two things. He can either take him to his library, open up hundreds of volumes of hadith books, and check up each issue, starting with takbir. Brother Bukhari says this about takbir, and Sahih Muslim says this, and Tirmidhi says this, and Nisa'i says this, Ibn Majah says this, Abu Dawud, and Muwatta of Imam Malik, Musannaf Ibn Abi Shayba, Musannaf Abdul Razak, Musannaf Abdul Razak, and other books, he says this. And so this is weak hadith, this is sahih hadith, and this has been narrated by this sahabi, this has been narrated by this sahabi, and so on. Or what he can, and that's just takbir. And then he goes to the rest of the salah, and or what he can do, he can say, brother, this is what we should do. When you want to pray, obviously go through wudu and other requisites first, and then when you come to actual prayer, he can either say, brother, you stand like this and you begin your prayer like this, go over whatever, you know, instructions by raising your hands either here or there or to the ears, whatever you say, Allahu Akbar, then you hold your hands, he shows them wherever, below the navel or above the navel or under the chest or on the chest, whatever the case might be. And he gives him instruction, step by step methodology. And then you recite Quran, ruku, sajda, and so on. And he explains to him the whole prayer, A to Z. But he doesn't make any reference to a single verse of Quran or any hadith. Just tells him, brother, do this, 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 from the beginning till the end. What do you think? And then this person, he starts praying like that. He came to Imam Sahib of the masjid, Imam who's recognized to be learned and who's gone through the training, because the masjid committee, before they employed him, they checked his certificates, they got references that he was a qualified alim. And then they employed him. He's gone to him because he's seen him leading prayers, giving sermons. So he goes up to him and thinking that he is a mashallah maulana, and everybody respects him, listens to him, and so he asks him. And seeing that this person is sincere and he wants to pray, mashallah, properly, so this Maulana Sahab, Mufti Sahab, Sheikh, he then gives him these step-by-step instructions. Begin your prayer like this, goes the whole prayer, right till the end. He doesn't make any reference to any verse of Quran or any hadith. Just tells him, do this, do this, do this, right till the end. And this person then starts praying like that. Do you think his prayer will be valid or not? Valid? Anybody disagree? If, for example, I'll present to you the other scenario. If anybody thinks that a person who prays has been given instruction step by step, but doesn't know any relevant part of Quran or any relevant hadith to back up his action with the sahih dalil, with references, if he doesn't know these dalils and references, his prayer is not valid, then don't you think that the prayer of 90 or even more percent of the ummah will not be valid? How many of you sitting here can back up your prayer with the references and evidences from the various books of hadith? Huh? Hardly anybody, huh? So if you need evidence and dalil for everything that you do in prayer, for then your prayer to be acceptable, that means hardly anybody here sitting, their prayer will be accepted, because they don't know the evidence. So the automatic and the correct answer is yes. If you don't know any hadith, any verse of Quran, which tells you how to pray, but you have learned to pray, say your prayer, from scholars, people of knowledge, and you are just obeying those instructions, your prayer would be valid. Most of you think it will, inshallah. And this is the correct opinion, inshallah. Let me take you back to the scenario I presented. The man comes to Mawlana Sahib. Mawlana Sahib, what do you think? What is your opinion on this issue, about the question I've presented? Mufti Sahib, if a person, he comes to a sheikh and says, teach me how to pray, and the Mufti Sahib, Mawlana Sahib, teaches this person step-by-step instructions, what to do, but makes no reference to any verse of Quran or hadith. Now let me clarify, I'm not saying they don't learn hadith, no, not for a moment, no. Learning hadith is important, it's so virtuous, it has its own importance and nobility. But ordinary person, he doesn't do that. And he just follows those instructions. Will his prayer be valid or not, Mufti Sahib? It'll be valid, inshallah. And let me take you back to the scenario that I presented. A man comes to the Imam Sahib and says, Mawlana Sahib, please teach me how to pray. Mawlana Sahib takes him home to the library. He opens out all these hundreds of volumes, because Sahih Bukhari is in many volumes, Muslim is in many volumes, Tirmizi is in many volumes, every book of hadith is in many, many volumes. And there are many, many books. So he opened these 100 volumes and to show him how to pray. So is he going to confuse this brother, or is he going to make it easy for this brother? Huh? So what will the brother say? He will say, Mawlana Sapri, just tell me what to do. So if this Imam, Mufti Sheikh, if he just tells this brother, the new brother who's sincere, wants to learn and pray properly, if he just gives him step-by-step instructions without necessarily making reference to the various different volumes, is he making things easy for him, doing him a favor, or misleading and corrupting him and confusing him? Huh? You agree? The elder says he's making it easy for him. Is he doing him a favor, or is he confusing him and misleading him? This is exactly what Imam Abu Hanifa did. Out of all the thousands upon thousands of hadiths that Allah enabled him to learn, he concluded, he made istinbat, he made ijtihad, and he presented deen to the ummah in simple to follow instructions. So was that doing the ummah a favor, or was that misleading and confusing the ummah? So if someone does you a favor, should you appreciate him, or should you curse and criticize him? Huh? Allahu Akbar. And I'm not saying this. Imam Jalaluddin Suyuti Rahmahullah, who's regarded and considered as one of the mujaddids. And mujaddids are those scholars Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke about, and he said, إن الله يبعث لهذه الأمة على رأس كل مئة سنة من يجدد لها دينها. Allah will raise for this ummah at the turn of every century a reformer who will revive deen. They are great people. They aren't just ordinary scholars. Rasulullah used the term yab'athu, similar to Rasul. They are not Rasuls. They are not infallible. They are not divinely protected as Rasuls are. But Allah chooses them to serve His cause. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, before he started, he had a dream. And the dream was that he was standing on the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was gathering the bones of Rasulullah. When he awakened, he was very shaken. Gathering the bones of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so he sent one of his friends, associates, to Ibn Sirin rahmahullah. Ibn Sirin was the great imam at the time in Tabiru Ru'ya, in interpreting dreams. And he was a senior tabi'i. And he was renowned for his interpretation of dreams. And much of the work that people use in order to interpret dreams is based on his work. He was pioneer in this field, Ibn Sirin rahmahullah. So he sent his friend and I said to him, ask what this dream means, but don't tell him that it's me you see. He felt very nervous, you know, seeing a dream like this, gathering the bones of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when he went and asked for the interpretation of the dream, Ibn Sirin, the first question he said was, who's seen this dream? He said, I can't tell you. He said, well, I can't tell you what he means then. And then he said, Abu Hanifa. He says, yes, a man like Abu Hanifa can see such a dream. And he said, it means Allah will enable him and he will gather the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because deen was revealed upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet preached to Sahaba and taught them. When Rasulullah passed away, Sahaba, they spread out far and wide. Some went to Syria, like Abu Darda radiallahu anhu. Others went to Egypt, to Palestine. Some came to Iraq, Basra, Kufa, and many parts of the world. So they had taken all that knowledge they had gathered from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and spread out in all parts of the world. And Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he had traveled many places and learned from the greatest scholars of his time. And then he set about compiling knowledge, bringing it together. Imam Jalaluddin Suyuti, I was saying, he stated, أَوَّلُ مَنْ دَوَّنَ عِلْمُ الشَّرِيَةِ وَرَتَّبَهُ أَبْوَابًا. That Abu Hanifa rahimahullah was the first man that Allah inspired, and he compiled, he made tadween, دَوَّنَ, to put it together, compiled. There's a difference between writing and authoring and compiling. Like Imam Bukhari compiled hadiths. He didn't invent and fabricate hadiths. He put them together. So Abu Hanifa rahimahullah put that knowledge of deen together. And he organized it in abwab, in chapters, in different walks of life. This is how you should pray. This is what you need to believe. This is how you need to pay zakat. This is how you need to do hajj. And when you do other things, this, these issues. Many issues, whatever he could gather from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the athar, sayings and practices of Sahaba. Many people, they say, oh, Abu Hanifa, he just speaks for his own opinion. Hashawak, he speaks his opinion on issues in which there is no clear guidance in the Quran and sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Rasulullah approved this himself when he sent Mu'az ibn Jabal radiallahu ta'ala to Yemen. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, O Mu'az, you will be presented with issues. So what will you do? He said, I will look to what is in the book of Allah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, فَإِن لَمْ تَجِدْ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. And if you don't find it in the book of Allah. Many people think, you know, for us Quran is enough. They don't even accept the authority and validity of hadith, because they claim the Quran says, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. We've revealed upon you the book which speaks about everything. So the Quran speaks about everything, so we don't need anything. If the Quran doesn't speak about everything, then the Quran has claimed wrongly. Because the Quran says, Allah says in the Quran, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ. We've revealed upon you the book, تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ, which makes clear everything. So if the Quran is right, then the Quran is claiming it speaks about everything. So if it speaks about everything, then you don't need anything else. So when Allahu Akbar, what an accusation on the Quran. The Quran says establish salat, but the Quran doesn't tell you how to establish salat. The Quran leads you to Rasulullah, Atiullah wa Atiur Rasul. Obey Allah, obey His Messenger. So you need to ask Rasulullah, learn from him how to pray. So Rasulullah is authority in deen. His sayings are authority in deen. His practices is deen. Whatever Rasulullah gives, ma ataakumur rasulu, Allah says in the Quran, whatever Rasul gives you, take it. فَخُذُوهُ. In other words, whatever he commands you, obey. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. Who, whatever he tells you to refrain from, stay away. So, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Mu'az ibn Jabal, Mu'az, How will you deal with issues? He said, I will look to the book of Allah. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, فَإِن لَمْ تَجِدْ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ, if you don't find it in the book of Allah. And then Muaz ibn Jabal replied, then I will look to the sunnah of his messenger. Rasulullah didn't say, oh Muaz, I was only testing you. How dare you say it's not in the book of Allah? He said, if it's not in the book of Allah, I will look to the sunnah of his messenger. And then Rasulullah said, فَإِن لَمْ تَجِدْ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَلَا فِي سُنَّةِ رَسُولِهِ, if you don't find it in the book of Allah and in the sunnah of his messenger, then what will you do? He said, أَجْتَهِدُ بِرَائِي وَلَا أَلُو, I will make ijtihad with my opinion and do my best. And then Rasulullah did, how dare you say I will make ijtihad and look to my opinion? Rasulullah didn't say that. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then patted his chest and he said, Alhamdulillahi alladhi waffaqa rasoola rasoolillahi. All praises for Allah who enabled the messenger of the messenger of Allah. Lima yarda bihi rasoolu, with whatever the messenger of Allah is happy. So Rasulullah was happy at the fact that people in this ummah, mujtahids, make ijtihad. Muaz ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu was a mujtahid sahabi. And when he said, I will make ijtihad and do my best, Rasulullah approved it. Rasulullah didn't reject it, criticize it, condemn it, put him down. How dare you say you will make ijtihad? So he made ijtihad according to his capacity. When the matter reached Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, there were so many issues arising new. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, whatever he came across, he says, ما جاء عن الله ورسوله فعلى الرأس والعين. Whatever is clear from Allah and his messenger, then we have to accept it open-heartedly. And whatever comes to us from the Sahaba, then we look to see which amongst the Sahaba were the most learned and whose opinion carried more weight, especially amongst the Khulafa Rashideen and the very learned Sahaba. And then whatever comes afterwards, and then we will better struggle with them, because he himself was a Tabi'i as well. Many people find it difficult to accept that Abu Hanifa Rahimahullah was a Tabi'i. And they said, no, he wasn't Tabi'i. But Imam Shamsuddin Zahabi Rahimahullah in Tazkiratul Huffaz has openly declared and stated and confessed that Abu Hanifa Rahimahullah, he saw Anas ibn Malik many times when he came to Iraq. Not just once. Ra'a Anas ibn Malik ghayra marratin. Not once, but many occasions. But Imam Sahib Rahimahullah himself, he stated, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَفْضَلْ مِنْ أَطَى. One of his teachers was Ata bin Abi Rabah Rahimahullah. So Imam Sahib said, people say, well, Imam Abu Hanifa himself says he hasn't seen anyone better than Ata. So Anas ibn Malik is obviously better than Ata, because Ata bin Abi Rabah Rahimahullah, who was the grand mufti of Makkah, student of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he was very learned, very pious, very respected, very honorable, but not a sahabi. And all sahaba are definitely better than tabi'ins. So when Imam Abu Hanifa stated and declared and claimed, I haven't seen anyone better than Ata, so it means that he did not see any sahabi. That's not what it means. Because when Anas ibn Malik radiallahu one who came to Iraq, Abu Hanifa rahimahullah was a small child. He was born in the year 80 after Hijrah, 70 years after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he heard things from Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, but he didn't become his disciple or student in the regular way. Whereas Ata bin Abi Rabah rahimahullah, Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he became a student for many years. So when he says, I didn't see anyone better than Ata, it means from amongst his other regular teachers. Allahu Akbar. And Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he didn't just see Anas ibn Malik. He saw number of different Sahaba. So he was amongst the Tabi'eens. And he is the only one from amongst the great Imams who was a Tabi'i. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just as he gave assurance of Sahaba, hadith reported in Tirmidhi, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا تمس النار مسلما رآني أو رآ من رآني. The fire will not touch anyone, any Muslim, implying Jahannam, will not touch a Muslim who has seen me or seen someone who's seen me. So Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah didn't see Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he saw many sahaba. And amongst them, the most famous Anas ibn Malik. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu served Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for a period of almost 10 years. And Imam Sahab's name was Noman bin Thabit. But his kuniyat means, amongst Arabs, it is common practice. If you ask anyone their name, then they won't usually tell you the name given to them by their parents. But as they, especially when they grow, in the beginning obviously they do, but when they grow up and get married and have a family of their own, Allah blesses them with children, then they often tell you their kuniya. Kuniya is a name which a person adopts, usually in a relation to his children. They will say Abu something, Abu Muhammad, Abu Yusuf, Abu Usman. And Abu usually means the father. General meaning is father. But it doesn't just mean father. And in Arabs, there are two types of kuniya. One is known as the kuniyat nasabi, which means kuniyat adopted because of family. Either in relation to their children or in relation to their parents. Like Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu is referred to as Ibn Abbas. Abdullah ibn Umar as Ibn Umar. So son of Umar, son of Abbas radiallahu anhu. Or sometimes Abu something, the father of so and so. But in Arabs, it's not just nasabi kuniyat which is used. There's another sort of kuniyat which is referred to as wasfi kuniyat. In other words, a kuniya, a name adopted or name given to someone because of their character or personality. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave such kuniyas to a number of different sahaba. And sahaba who are very famous. The most famous of all the sahaba is Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Many people say, oh you Hanafis, you follow an imam who has become famous because of his daughter. Abu Hanifa, they say, means the father of Hanifa. Hanifa is a girl's name. Hanifa was his daughter's name. That is absolute rubbish. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah had no daughter by the name of Hanifa. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah had only one son. His name was Hammad. Imam Abu Hanifa named him after his main teacher, Hammad bin Abi Sulaiman, rahimahumullah. And he did not have a daughter by the name of Hanifa. And a supposed story is assigned that once Imam Abu Hanifa was asked a question which he couldn't answer. And the question presented was that a man is allowed to marry four women at a time, but a woman can't marry four husbands at a time. Why is that? So Abu Hanifa didn't know an answer to this question. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, Allah blessed him with such wisdom, he was able to solve much more complicated issues instantly. And this is common knowledge amongst ulama. Perhaps might not be amongst the public, but you ask any alim and they will tell you. And this is common, it's a common criticism made upon Islam and Muslims. And so the imam, supposedly the great imam, went home all worried, looking anxious and almost depressed, looking worried. And his daughter saw her father worried. So she approached him asking, "Father, why are you so worried?" "Because someone asked me a question I had no answer for." "What's the question?" "The question is, why is it that a man can marry four women and women can't marry four men? Where's the equality? It's injustice. So I don't know what to say." So his daughter, whose name was supposedly Hanifa, she said, "Well, I'll give you the answer, but on my condition. My condition is that I want you then to associate yourself with regards to me, adopt my name in your title, in your kuniya, and then I will give you the answer." And then he agreed. And he agreed to be known in relation to his daughter rather than his son. So she then came up with the solution and answer, which was, she said, she gathered four women and she said to them to present, you know, or she said, you know, bring milk of different animals, four goats, and then mix it together and then ask them to separate it. Can it be separated? It can't be separated. So similarly, if a woman was to marry four men, then how will she possibly be able to tell whose child she is carrying. So the Imam was supposedly very satisfied and with this, and convinced with this answer. So hence he became known as Abu Hanifa. And if this had any truth to it, so it just shows a young girl had more intelligence than her learned and famous father, who became known as the greatest Imam in this Ummah. In fact, if anything, this is an insult to an ordinary person's intelligence. How can such a great Imam, who used to present instant solutions to many far more complex problems instantaneously, not know a solution like this, to a question like this? And the fact is that Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah had no such daughter. So this is a totally fabricated scenario and a fabricated story. And whereas in reality, the fact is, Hanif is a word used in the Quran. Hanif means pure, sincere. Allah has used it to describe Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. وَاتَّبِي مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا. Just like Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr, the literal meaning father of Bakr, but Abu Bakr had no son by the name of Bakr. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had three sons: Abdurrahman bin Abi Bakr, Abdullah bin Abi Bakr, and Muhammad bin Abi Bakr. There is not a single book in the entire Islamic literature which lists Bakr as one of the sons of Abu Bakr. Bakr was his wasf, was his character. Abu Bakr was always the best and the first in everything. So he became famous as being the master and the best and always the first. Hence Abu Bakr. Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu did not have a daughter by the name of Huraira. Once he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam carrying a kitten. Rasulullah looked at him and smiled and addressed him, "Ya Aba Huraira, oh the one with the kitten, not oh you the father of the kitten." Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu had an argument with Hazrat Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Husband and wife had an argument. Hazrat Ali walked out. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Hazrat Fatima, saw her weeping and crying, worried. Asked, she said, "Well, we had an argument, Ali's walked out." Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to the masjid, saw Hazrat Ali lying on the floor, covered in dust. And Rasulullah said, "Qum ya Aba Turab, you covered in dust, you Abu Turab, if Abu means father, you father of dust." Did Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu have a son by the name of Turab? So no, it just described his appearance that he was covered in dust. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam addressed him as such. So it proves that in Arabs, even among Sahaba, there were many people who had this kunya which described their personality and character. So Abu Hanifa means the one who's pure, the one who is sincere, the one who is clean and good through and through. Not father of a girl by the name of Hanifa. And he was so sincere. Allahu Akbar. Once a woman came to him wanting to sell a piece of cloth. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah was a cloth merchant. He dealt with in cloth. So she came wanting to sell a piece of cloth. Imam Sahib asked her, "Woman, how much do you want for this?" She said, 100 dirhams. Imam Sahib said, "It's worth much more." She said, 200. "It's worth even more." She said, 300. "It's worth even more." "You kidding me? Making fun of me?" "No, no, it's worth more." Imam Sahib gave her 400 dirhams. Had it been somebody like us, "How much do you want?" 100. "You must be joking. It's not worth 10. Imam Sahib genuinely, Allah is amanat, his trust, honesty. Look at, and he said he gave her 400 for something she wanted. She would have been happy with only 100. If he would have given her 100, he wouldn't have been cheating her. But he didn't even want to take advantage of someone, let alone cheat. You know, many people, they would put the price down or do things. Subhanallah. And you know, just to cheat people. He wasn't cheating. He didn't even want to take advantage. So a person who doesn't want to take advantage of someone in matters of dunya, do you think he would have ever wanted to cheat people in matters of deen? This is the trustworthiness of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. And a wonderful example of how it shows why he acquired that title Abu Hanifa. He was so sincere. He was so upright. He was so humble. And he was so honest in character that people, they recognized him as Abu Hanifa. The one who's full of sincerity, purity, honesty. Allahu Akbar. Coming back to the fact, why people follow Imam Abu Hanifa. When I said, we follow Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, not in comparison to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but in order to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are many issues in our deen which are clear. There is no ambiguity, there is no controversy, and there is no problem with such issues. They are clearly defined issues. There are issues in our deen which are clearly defined, and then there are those issues which are not clearly defined, or in which there is controversy, or in which there is ambiguity. The issues which are clear. How many times do Muslims pray worldwide? How many? Five times. Hanafis? Shafis? Salafis? Everywhere Muslims pray five times. From Ahlu Sunnah wal Jama'ah at least, we all pray. Whether you Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi, Salafi, they all pray five times a day. What's the first prayer? Fajr. Then Dhuhr. Then Asr, Maghrib, Isha. Everybody? Hanafis, Shafis, Salafis, everybody? How many rakats do people pray Faraz for Fajr? Everybody? How many you pray in this masjid? Perhaps you Hanafis here, you don't know, you know. You pray two rakats here? In Salafi masjids, Shafis, everybody pray. When you begin your prayer, how do you begin? With Allahu Akbar, everybody does. Hanafis, Shafis, Salafis. Hanafis perhaps do it differently. No? Everybody does the same. Allahu Akbar. Then they make Qiyam, recite Quran, Surah. And then after that, everybody goes to Ruku. Everybody does the same. Is that what you do here? Everybody, whether you Salafi, Hanafi, Shafi, Maliki, everybody, you begin your salah with Takbir, Allahu Akbar, you hold your hands, the difference of opinion where, but you hold your hands, and then you recite Quran, you go to Ruku, you stand from Ruku, then you make Sajda, one Sajda, then get up, then make second Sajda, you complete one Rakat. And if there's two Rakats to be prayed, you repeat the whole process, second Rakat, you sit down, and then at the end of the second rakat, how do you complete your prayer and conclude it? By making salam. Is that how Hanafis do it? Salafis? Everybody does the same? So these are unanimously accepted issues, clear issues, defined issues. So there is no controversy. The only controversy is, how far do you raise your hands? Some do it to the shoulders, some do a bit higher. Some hold their hands low, some slightly higher, some bit here, some bit here. And then when people go into ruku, some go straight into ruku, some raise their hands before ruku. And some raise their hands after ruku as well, others don't. So there's differences, controversy in the nitty-gritty. These are known as furu' masail, issues in which ijtihad is required, because there are hadiths reported by Sahaba from the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which different scenarios are narrated. Some say the Prophet prayed like this. Some say Prophet prayed like this. In Sahih Bukhari, for example, Imam Bukhari rahimahullah has presented a narration of Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who says, I saw the Prophet raising his hands before going into ruku and after he stood up from ruku. Other Sahaba, amongst them the most prominent Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, about whom Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated, مَا حَدَّثَكُمْ إِبْنُ مَسْعُودٍ فَصَدِّقُوا. Whatever Ibn Mas'ud says to you, accept it, that he's telling you the truth. Imam Bukhari has presented a narration in Sahih Bukhari, in which he says, Hazrat Huzaifa radiallahu anhu, who himself is a prominent Sahabi, he was asked, who is the man who resembled the Prophet most in conduct dealing in affairs? And he said,
Inna ashbaha an-nas dallan wa samta wa hadiyan bi Rasulillah la ibn Umm Abdin. The man who resembled the Prophet most in conduct, dealing, and habits was Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. So he would say, Ala usalli bikum salata Rasulillah, faqama fasalla falam yarfa'u yadayhi illa fi awwala marratin. He would say, Shall I show you the prayer of the Prophet? And that he would stand and pray and raise his hands only in the beginning, and not before ruku and after ruku. So one sahabi, he says, Shall I show you, and the Prophet did this. Another sahabi says, This is the prayer of the Prophet. And he doesn't. So you have a controversy. So rather than you make your own decision and judgment, some people say, just because it's in Bukhari, this is more authentic. Well, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he was praying with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam before Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu was even born. And the other hadith which Imam Bukhari has presented by Malik ibn Hawairis radiallahu anhu, he was only ever with the Prophet for 20 days in his entire life. He came to Medina, became a Muslim, came to Medina, stayed 20 days. After that, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw young man missing his family, homesick. Rasulullah allowed him to go back home. So he went back. Next time he came to Medina, Rasulullah had passed away. So on one side, you have a sahabi who was with Rasulullah only 20 days in his entire life. We are not saying what he did is wrong, or what he is saying is wrong. What he is saying is right. But on the other side, you have a sahabi who was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 23 years from the beginning till the end, and was always with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Himself has been praised by the Prophet. Other sahaba acknowledged him to be the most learned. He is saying something else. So doesn't that carry weight as well? And so because in the later part of his life, Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu sent Abdullah ibn Mas'ud to Kufa, and he, as a teacher, so he taught the people of Kufa, and Imam Abu Hanifa rahmahullah was born in Kufa, so he was an heir to the legacy of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who is recognized to be amongst the most learned amongst the Sahaba. So if anybody knew Rasulullah well, and amongst the best, then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is definitely amongst those who knew Rasulullah the best. So this is, hence in Fiqh Hanafi, most of the ijtihad of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah is based around the teachings or the practices of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud from what he reports on behalf through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there are issues in our deen which are straightforward, unanimously accepted, no difference, no complication, no controversy, clearly defined, and everybody in Ahlu Sunnah wal Jama'ah is in unanimous agreement in such issues. Like how many prayers? Where do people go for Hajj? Makkah? Where do Salafis go for Hajj? Hanafis? They all go to Makkah. Anybody going to Hajj from here? Where have they gone? Pakistan? Everybody goes for Hajj where? Makkatul Mukarrama. Because it's a clearly defined, unanimously accepted, no controversy, ambiguity, difficulty. So unanimously accepted issue. Other issues, the evidence is controversial. Ordinary person doesn't have the authority to pass a judgment and draw his own conclusion. The Quran leads us to mujtahid scholars. So the first issue is controversial issues. The other issues, ambiguous issues. These are three words. If you can remember three words, then you'll have no problem. Number one, controversial issues. Number two, ambiguous issues. Ambiguous issues means the Prophet ﷺ said something, but different people can interpret it in different ways. Used to happen in the time of the Prophet ﷺ as well. An incident Imam Bukhari has reported in his compilation, in his Sahih. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent a group of Sahaba to Banu Qurayza with specific orders. لا يسلين أحدكم إلا في بني قريظة. None of you should pray your Asr Salat except in Banu Qurayza. Sahaba became delayed. And when they were leaving, one group said, look, the Prophet meant, you know, that we should leave early and get to Banu Qurayza before Asr Salat. But we have already become delayed, so we need to pray, so we should pray. So some of them prayed. The other group said, no, the Prophet said, none of you should pray except in Banu Qurayza, so we will not pray. Even if we miss, we will go there. So they missed their salat. Or they became delayed. And when the matter was reported to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet did not admonish anyone. So different sahaba interpreted apparently a clear or a small command of Rasulullah in different ways. The Prophet accepted that interpretation. So there can be something which appears to be clear, but different people, knowledgeable people, see it as differently, so they interpret it different ways. Ordinary people are not authorized to make their interpretation, because the Quran commands us to follow mujtahid scholars. You follow their interpretation and their understanding. And the third issue is undefined issues. Undefined issues are those issues in which there is no clear guidance. Because deen is a perfect, our deen is a perfect deen or imperfect deen? Complete way of life or incomplete? So if it's a complete way of life, perfect deen, so there should be instructions regarding all aspects of life. But are there clear instructions in the Quran and Hadith regarding everything? Are there? If you're traveling in train, how should you pray? Is there anything in the Quran regarding prayer in train? Was there train in the time of the Prophet? So does our deen not cater for such issues? So this is an undefined issue. An issue which has not been made clearly spoken about in the Quran. If you ever get to the moon, how do you pray on the moon? If a Muslim astronaut goes to the moon, or a Muslim shouldn't go on the moon because there is no... Or traveling by air in an aeroplane. Does it state anywhere in the Quran how you should pray, or whether you should pray, or whether you shouldn't pray in the aeroplane? Is there any verse in the Quran? Did the Prophet ever make mention in any hadith, whether sahih or da'if, there will come a time when people will travel by aeroplanes in the air, don't travel by airplane. Did the Prophet ever say that? Or did the Prophet ever say, if there is a need to travel in an aeroplane and the time for salat sets in, then don't pray in the aeroplane. Or pray in this manner. So this is an undefined issue. Huh? So what do you do in undefined issues? There's another example. The Prophet ﷺ has made mention of a fact, if a fly falls into your food, then what should you do? Dip it into the food and throw it out and eat the rest of the food. The Prophet has mentioned a fly, but flies are not the only things which fall in people's foods, especially in India, Pakistan. Also, mosquitoes and things also food. So now you can either say, why did you, oh you mosquito, you must be a ghair muqallid mosquito or whatever. You don't believe in Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You must be a kafir mosquito, astaghfirullah. Because the Prophet hasn't given instructions to us what we should do if you fall into our food. So you shouldn't have fallen into our food. But do mosquitoes listen? So now what should you do? Does it make any mention in the Quran if a mosquito falls into your food? There is no hadith anywhere which states as well that if a mosquito falls into your food, there's mention of a fly, but no mention of a mosquito or an ant. So what should you do then? So what people like Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, mujtahids have done is to compare a known scenario with an unknown scenario, with similarity. This is known as qiyas. To compare an unknown scenario with a given scenario if there is a similarity. Or in light of Quran and Hadith, the fundamental principles established if there's a new scenario. Like for example, children who go to school. One of the fundamental subjects taught worldwide is mathematics. Yeah? And when children who attend mathematics classes, you know, they are taught how to add, subtract, multiply and divide. They are taught principles. But are they trained or are they made to solve every imaginable possible combination? Huh? They are taught main principles by which they can solve any given scenario. Yes? Or do children actually get taught and they are made to go through every possible combination of addition, subtraction, multiplication and division. If they did, they'll be all life, you know, they won't be able to get come to an end of all the different combinations. They are taught main principles by which you can solve any combination. So similarly, mujtahid scholars apply the fundamental principles given in Quran and Hadith to any given scenario by which you can then present an Islamic solution. This is what Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah pioneered, and he was the first person to set about presenting new scenarios, and many times he won't even imagine scenarios. And many people, they make fun of Abu Hanifa rahimahullah and refer to this issue sarcastically as the what ifer, or what if this happens and what if that happens. Na'udhu billah min thalik. In fact, this was a favor Abu Hanifa rahimahullah tried to do to the ummah, that prepared the people in advance that when such scenarios occur, there will be guidance already in place. And to say, what if, this is also sunnah of Allah. Allah has mentioned in the Quran, لَوْ كَانَ فِيهِمَا آلِهَةٌ إِلَّا اللَّهُ لَفَسَدَتَ. There is no other God besides Allah. But if there were two gods or other gods, there would have been chaos. So Allah has used the terminology, if this happens, then this would have been the scenario, the result. If there was a God other than Allah, لَوْ كَانَ فِيهِمَا آلِهَةٌ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. Had there been a God other than Allah, لَفَسَدَتَ, there would have been chaos. So Allah has used that example of if. Rasulullah has used examples of if in many hadith. لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ مَا أَعْلَمْ. If you knew what I know, لَضَحِكْتُمْ قَلِيلًا وَلَبَكَيْتُمْ كَثِيرًا. You would laugh very little and cry a lot. So Rasulullah used that scenario. Allah has used it in the Quran. So if Abu Hanifa used it, rahimahullah, so what's the problem? But people, they look at it and they make fun of Abu Hanifa. One man, well, it's a book, Abu Amina Bilal Phillips, in the evolution of Fiqh, he refers to Imam Abu Hanifa as one of the what-ifers. So what if this happens? What if? Yes, there were other ulama at the time who, when presented with new situations, Shaykh, if this happens, what's the answer? And they would say, has it actually happened? They would say, no, it hasn't happened, but we just want to know. They would say, well, don't ask us until it happens. If it happens, then come and ask us. But Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he wanted to be prepared for that. Not just be prepared, but prepare others to be prepared. So was that doing the ummah a favor or confusing the ummah? So Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, because of his sincerity, humility, piety, honesty, he was just trying to make things easy for the ummah. But people, they see things backwards. They regard it as, subhanallah, as a point of criticism for Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, when in reality it is a plus for Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. And people, so we were saying, so when people say they follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, they don't follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah in relation to Rasulullah, but in order to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there is no issue. When people, sometimes people, they confuse many young people and they say, brother, who are you going to follow? Imam Abu Hanifa or Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And say, well, Imam Rasulullah said this in Bukhari, and it's the most authentic book after the book of Allah. Your Imam Sahib says this. So who are you going to follow? Your Imam or Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So if somebody comes to you and say, brother, look, Rasulullah did this, and your Imam says do this, so who are you going to follow? Ordinary Muslim gets confused. He obviously, he wants to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, but Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah has stated this as well, and ulama have stated, if you follow one of the great imams, you are his muqallid. Even if someone brings to you a hadith and says, look, this is sahih hadith, the Prophet has done this and your imam is saying this, be happy with what your imam is saying. You are not rejecting the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You are rejecting his presentation of the hadith, because he is probably not giving to you the complete picture. There is a reason why, if there is a hadith that you think the imam has overlooked or rejected, or somebody says, Like one famous brother, he says, at the time of Abu Hanifa, hadith hadn't been compiled yet. Because compilation of hadith took place in the 3rd century. Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, was born in the year 80 after Hijrah. In other words, 70 years after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imam Bukhari was born in the year 184. In other words, 174 years after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. And most of his work was based in the 3rd century of Islam. And then many of the great muhaddisun came after him. Imam Muslim, Tirmizi, Imam Abu Dawud and so on. They came after Imam Bukhari rahimahullah. So much of the compilation of hadith took place in the 3rd century of Islam. So one of the things, brother Dr. Zakir Naik sahab, damat barakatum, what he says, because hadith wasn't compiled in the time of Abu Hanifa, so Imam Abu Hanifa probably didn't know this hadith, because hadith was compiled in the 3rd century of Islam. So if this is such a baseless argument, and in fact, it's a misleading argument. Because if this has any weight in it, then that means many of the practices of Sahaba can't be relied upon, because compilation of hadith hadn't even begun in the time of Sahaba. So not all the Sahaba even knew all the hadiths. So just because compilation of hadith didn't take place till the 3rd century of Islam, wasn't completed, it doesn't mean that Abu Hanifa rahimahullah didn't know an issue. In fact, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, especially when it comes to common issues like prayer, if there is a remote issue which occurred once in the Prophet's life somewhere in the jungle and out in the wilderness, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had perhaps just one or two people around with him, then yes, we could say yes, Abu Hanifa rahimahullah perhaps might not have become aware. But in an issue as close and as common and as frequent as prayer, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed in public 18,000 times. The daily prayers Rasulullah used to pray without exception in public, in Jamaat, every day, 5 times a day. Every month 150 prayers. In 1 year 1800 prayers. In 10 years Rasulullah prayed 18,000 times in congregation, in public. So if there is an issue regarding prayer, don't you think Imam would have known? And in any case, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, the hadith, for example, Rafa Yadain, many people say Abu Hanifa perhaps didn't know this hadith. And this hadith has been reported in Sahih Bukhari by Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, do you think he used to pray? You think Sahaba used to pray? So when they used to give dars, time for salat would set in, do you think they would pray? One of his most prominent students, one was his own son, Salim bin Abdullah, and another one was Nafi, he was his student. And Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, amongst other tabi'een, also spent substantial time in the company of Nafi rahimahullah as well, who was a student of Abdullah ibn Umar. And Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu is one of the main narrators of Rafa Yadain. So it's impossible Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah went to a student of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu and yet failed to observe his prayer. Many a times people read books of hadith and they find a hadith. And then they say, look, Imam Abu Hanifa, for example, he says differently. Hadith is saying this and the Imam is saying this. Imam Abu Hanifa doesn't listen to hadith or he doesn't know the hadith. Many a times it's not just a question of just looking to what the hadith is saying. It's an issue of understanding what Rasulullah meant as well. When Hudaybiyah occurred, do you know the incident of Hudaybiyah when Rasulullah came for Umrah? He'd seen a dream and he came for Umrah. Meccans intervened, didn't allow Rasulullah to enter Makkah. And so the Prophet camped at Hudaybiyah and there was extensive dialogue. Eventually it was agreed that a truce will be agreed. Sulu. The terms were being written. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam dictated the terms, and on behalf of Rasulullah, Hazrat Ali was writing. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started dictating, and the Prophet said, this is agreement between Muhammadur Rasulullah. So the people objected. No, don't write Muhammadur Rasulullah, rub it out. That's the whole problem. We don't accept you as Rasulullah. If we accepted you as Rasulullah, then there would be no problem. So Rasulullah then said to Hazrat Ali, Ali, wipe it out, rub it out. Rasulullah saying to Hazrat Ali directly, rub it out. That Rasulullah bit. Hazrat Ali said, Wallahi la amhaha. I swear by Allah, I will not rub it out. Rasulullah is telling him directly to rub it out. And Hazrat Ali is saying, Wallahi, I swear by Allah, I will not rub it out. So people who are quick to criticize Abu Hanifa rahimahullah or any other imam, look, the Prophet said this, your imam is saying this. What will their fatwa be with regard to Hazrat Ali? Rasulullah is telling him directly to rub it out. And he is saying, Wallahi la amhaha. I swear by Allah, I will not rub it out. So, did Hazrat Ali do this in defiance of Rasulullah or in love of Rasulullah? He understood what Rasulullah really wanted. His iman didn't allow. But that apparent direct denial of the hadith of Rasulullah. I've already given an example of another incident. When the Prophet ﷺ sent people to Banu Qurayza and said, none of you should pray Asr except in Banu Qurayza. Sahaba, the hadith says, don't pray except in Banu Qurayza. Sahaba prayed. Why? Because they realized that what Rasulullah meant was, we should leave early, but we become delayed. So there was a reason. And they looked up to what Rasulullah really wanted. There are many books of hadith in which it is stated. The Prophet said, Albisu thiyab al abyad, wear white clothes. Rasulullah said, wear white clothes. Are you wearing white? Why aren't you wearing white? So does anybody ever say, brother, Rasulullah said, wear white. Why are you wearing black? Brother, you disobeying Rasulullah, going against his command. Rasulullah said, wear white, and you wearing black. So does anybody ever say, brother, you are disobeying Rasulullah? Does anybody ever say that? Why? Because they say, this is a recommendation. So when there's a recommendation, preferable, but there is tolerance for the other side as well. But Rasulullah said, wear white. Ordinary person doesn't understand that. A mujtahid gives a total overall conclusion. There's another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imam Bukhari has reported it in his Sahih as well. The Prophet said, لا يتمنى أحدكم الموت. None of you should wish for death. Because if you're a good person, then every day you live, your piety, good deeds will increase. But even if you're a sinful person, there's a good chance you'll repent. But if you die, then you've lost that chance. So don't wish for death. The Prophet said, if you need to pray, then make a dua, Ya Allah, Allahumma ahyini ma kanatil hayatu khairali, wa tawaffani ma kanatil wafatu khairali. Ya Allah, keep me alive as long as it is better for me to live, and when it is better for me to die, then take me away. The Prophet said, don't wish for death because of hardship. Imam Bukhari has reported this. He knew this hadith. But Imam Bukhari himself prayed for death. In his later days of life, in his biography it's written, one of his students says, Imam Bukhari rahimahullah, one night he got up and he said, Allahumma innahu daqat alayya al-ardu bima rahubat faqbidni ilayk. Ya Allah, things have become very difficult for me, so take me away. Imam Bukhari knew the hadith. He's reported it in there. But he prayed for death. So how many would say, Imam Bukhari, oh, don't listen to Imam Bukhari. He went against hadith. He understood what the hadith meant. The hadith says, don't wish for death or pray for death because of hardship. That's all it says. But Imam Bukhari understood it to mean, don't pray for death because of hardship of dunya. Things were getting difficult for his deen. It was becoming very difficult for him to live. His deen was in danger. So he exempted himself and prayed for this. So there are many issues which are needed in order to understand hadith properly. So mujtahid comes up with this overall conclusions from all the hadiths and presents Islam and deen in a practical step by step follow methodology. So is that making deen easy for the ummah or misleading the ummah? So Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, as Imam Jalaluddin Suyuti rahimahullah stated, he was the first person in this ummah to compile deen and organize it in different sections of life. So did he do the ummah a favor or confuse and mislead the ummah? So if he's done the ummah a favor, should we appreciate his service or should we criticize and reject his service? May Allah guide us. Mm-hmm. So this is like you can appreciate, there's many other issues, brothers, but in this short session, you know, we've tried to cover the main points. So alhamdulillah, like we said, it's essential that we try and assure our youth that by following Imam Abu Hanifa and the great scholars of Islam, you are on the right path. They were leaders of Ahlu Sunnah wal Jama'ah. They didn't confuse, mislead or reject hadith in any way. They presented to the ummah the best possible understanding of hadith. May Allah Rabbul Alameen grant us understanding. Have mercy upon us and keep us all on the right path. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi subhanakallah.
يا حامل القرآن